Hey everybody, it's Rishi Agarwal, and in this video I'm going to show you another classic case. This case started with this chest x-ray, and I'm going to give you a second to make the finding. It's right here. If you look in the right upper lung, superimposed over the second rib is this nodule. I can't really see it on the lateral view. It would be in this general area right here, but there's nothing really that I can point out on the lateral view. A CT was ordered for further characterization, and it showed this well-circumscribed nodule in the right upper lobe. It's about 12 millimeters in size, and if you look at the bronchovascular bundle that leads to that main nodule, it's studded with multiple smaller nodules. And if you look at another adjacent bronchovascular bundle, that too is studded with a few small nodules. When we look at the soft tissue windows, it looks like there's a little bit of fullness in the right hilum, but it's difficult to differentiate a lymph node from a vessel because we don't have contrast. So this appearance is a classic granuloma. Specifically, this is from histoplasmosis. The reason why I want to show you this case is because the radiologist has a big role to play in cases like this. If you were familiar with the morphology, with this well-circumscribed central nodule and smaller nodules in a peribronchovascular distribution, then you can make a confident call of a granuloma and save the patient time, money, heartache, and morbidity by steering the management towards a follow-up chest CT rather than doing a PET CT, a biopsy, or surgery. And even if you were a little worried about it, you could do the initial follow-up study in 1 to 2 months, and then do another in about 6 months, and then another in 12 months. Histoplasma capsulatum is a common endemic fungal infection. If you remember that term from med school, endemic infection refers to an infection that happens commonly, but it's confined to certain areas of the world or country. This is the first map of histoplasma prevalence in the United States, and it was published in 1969 when some researchers performed skin testing for histoplasma among new naval recruits and then traced them back to their specific county of origin. And it showed a large concentration of histoplasma here in the Midwest of the United States and a much lower prevalence elsewhere. These areas here in California were thought to be due to cross-reactivity to another fungal infection. Today, because of a number of reasons, the map of the United States probably looks something like this, where the eastern United States has a high concentration of histoplasma and the western has a lower concentration. That's not to imply that the western United States has no cases, but the numbers are just lower compared to the eastern US. Here's a world map that was based on a literature search published in the journal Micropathologia in 2020. It's important to remember that histoplasmosis can be found worldwide, so the highest numbers are going to be found in the places that are green, but sporadic cases can occur even in these darker areas. In endemic areas, histo is found in the soil, and it's in particularly high concentrations in soil that has a lot of bird or bat droppings. So that's why a classic test question is that you have a patient who goes spelunking and catches histo. But you don't really have to live in rural areas or near caves to get it. Even in urban areas, like under trees or where a lot of birds hang out, or during construction or cleanup of an area, it's possible to be exposed to histo. If you're looking at soil containing histo under the microscope, you're going to find fungal hyphae, as well as these things called microconidia and macroconidia. Another name for these conidia are spores, and when the dirt or soil gets stirred up, these spores are released into the air and breathed in by the patient. And in the lungs, the fungus can cause a pneumonia, but in most patients, like over 99%, they have no symptoms or very minimal symptoms. And so most patients don't even seek medical care, and imaging is not usually obtained. It's only later, after the body fights off the infection, that the remnants of the infection are found in the form of a granuloma. And if that granuloma hasn't had time to calcify, then you're left with something like this. In adults, it can take a long time for the nodule to calcify. Like in this patient, it took 3 years to get to this point where the lesion measured 100 Hounsfield units, and you can see with the naked eye some faint calcification. But if you put an ROI over it, you can see that even in 2 years, it went from 25 Hounsfield units to 60 Hounsfield units, indicating some low-level calcification. The lymph nodes will also calcify. This is the CT that was done 4 years after the initial, and you can see there's a peribronchial lymph node that's calcified, and that initial hilar lymph node that we were concerned about has calcified. Now, I mentioned earlier that most patients have either no symptoms or very mild symptoms. So some patients can have moderate to severe pulmonary illness, and that can happen if the patient is immunocompromised with like HIV/AIDS or pharmacological immunosuppression, or it can happen if the patient inhales a large inoculum of the spores. This is a patient that presented with cough and dyspnea, and I want to show you the natural history of the granuloma formation. Here's a patient who had right lower lobe ground glass opacity. And in the center of that ground glass opacity, there's a more focal oval consolidation, which on soft tissue windows has a low area of density centrally, indicating necrosis. When we go up to the mediastinum, you'll see enlarged lymph nodes in the subcarinal region and in the right hilum. 4 months after the initial CT, you'll see that the ground glass opacity has went away, and we're left with this central nodule, which has become much smaller in size. On soft tissue windows, the nodule isn't yet calcified and has a mean Hounsfield unit of about 35. 11 months after the initial CT, the nodule is more well circumscribed, but not really changed in size or density. 2.5 years after the initial study, the nodule is about the same size as it was before. But if we look at the soft tissue windows, you can see some faint laminated calcification, kind of like a jawbreaker candy. This is 10 years after the initial study, and you can see that the nodule has decreased in size. And on soft tissue windows, that laminated appearance of calcification has become even more pronounced, with dense calcification around the periphery and in the middle of the lesion. Here's another example. We have a solid, very well circumscribed dominant nodule surrounded by multiple smaller nodules that seem to abut the bronchovascular bundle. Occasionally, these can be confused for arteriovenous malformations because the nodules abut the vessels that lead into the main lesion. That's not to be confused with a tortuous dilated vessel. It's just that there's nodular studding of the vessels leading to the lesion. Here's one with obvious calcification. We have this central dominant nodule that's well circumscribed and multiple surrounding satellite nodules in a bronchovascular distribution. And then we have calcification of that ipsilateral lymph node. When the patient is first infected, the organism is taken up by macrophages, but it isn't killed, and that's how it can enter the bloodstream, where it can be deposited in the spleen and liver, and those granulomas in the spleen can eventually calcify. And that's why patients with histo often have calcified splenic granulomas, like this patient. Here's one last example. So here's a patient with a central dominant nodule and a couple surrounding satellite nodules. But what you'll notice is that this dominant nodule is not well circumscribed. Instead, it has spiculated borders. And on the coronals, you can see that spiculation very well. So this patient is not a granuloma because the central nodule is not well circumscribed, it's spiculated. This patient is going to require a PET CT and thoracic surgery consultation, and this patient turned out to be lung cancer. Okay, in summary, if you have a solid, well-circumscribed nodule and surrounding smaller nodules in a peribronchovascular distribution, this is a very good sign of a granuloma, specifically histoplasmosis. So if you live in an endemic area and you see these features, then I would recommend doing a follow-up CT in 1 to 3 months, depending on the size of the lesion and how typical the features are. After that first follow-up, you can lengthen the time interval for the follow-up scans. If you recommend a PET CT, the lesion and the lymph nodes are going to be hot on PET, which might persuade someone to biopsy or even remove it. So I think it's better to just follow it with a regular non-contrast chest CT. If you have any questions about this topic or any other chest radiology topic, let me know in the comments below. Thanks.